Hello friends, welcome to Tech Greens. In continuation to our series of Spark interview questions, today we are going to look what is RDD in Spark. So guys, it's a very important topic. Let's understand what is RDD in Spark. So RDD stands for Resilient Distributed Data Set. So it is a fundamental data structure of Spark, and it has been the primary user-facing API in Spark since its inception. So this data structure and this data set is available with Spark since the beginning of the Spark. So that's why it is also called the fundamental data structures of Spark. All the data structures which have come into Spark with the newer versions like data sets and data frames in Spark 2.0 and further are also built on top of RDDs. So let's see what are the different characteristics of RDD. Each data set in RDD is divided into logical partitioning. Now guys, this is very important, because if the data is logically partitioned within RDD, it is possible to send the different pieces of data across different nodes in the cluster for distributed computing. That's the design thinking which is kept while keeping the logical partitions within RDD. Another important factor about RDD is it is immutable. That means you cannot change the state of RDD. If you want to change the state of one particular RDD, you will have to create a new one. And immutability of RDD is a great asset in the distributed computing. We'll look in the next slide how immutability helps in achieving a greater distributed and parallel data processing. Now, as we have seen in the point number 3, that data set is divided into logical partition, and thus it helps us to send those partitions across cluster for processing. Another example where RDD is the right design thinking, because it helps Spark to achieve faster and efficient data processing. Because now with RDD, Spark, while processing that RDD, doesn't have to keep into account what is the state of that RDD. As RDD is immutable, there we don't have to preserve or maintain the state of the RDD even while processing. Okay. Now let's see how does immutability of RDD helps, and what is the design thinking behind keeping RDDs as immutable. As we have seen, RDDs are inherently immutable in Spark across any version. Since inception, RDDs are always immutable, which makes them an ideal candidate for parallel processing across multiple threads, because now we don't have to maintain the state. We don't take into account that what is the state of the underlying resource while multiple threads are accessing it, because now each thread would have its own copy of RDD as it is immutable. Another important factor about RDD is they're not just immutable but also a deterministic function of their inputs. What does it mean? That whatever the function is used to create an RDD, they can always be recreated with the same function. So they are always deterministic from the functional standpoint how they are created. This design helps us in achieving the fault tolerance in the Spark world. Think of the scenario, say a particular RDD is sitting on a particular node in the cluster, and for some reason that node got down. Now what will happen? The deterministic function of that RDD is already recorded. So now the same RDD using that deterministic function can be created on another node in the cluster, another available node in the cluster. So thus the design of RDD helps us in achieving the fault tolerance without even developer writing any single line of code for that. So that is like provided out of the box courtesy the design of RDD, which is immutable. Now another important factor about immutable data is it is very easy to keep immutable data into the primary memory, which is your RAM, or which is your in-memory, what we say. And now we can keep them easily in the memory it helps us Spark to achieve the faster in-memory computes. At the same time, as we have already discussed in the last point, it's mentioned that immutable RDDs help us to achieve the fault tolerance without any developer's effort. And we have already discussed that why and how we achieve fault tolerance, because they're not just only immutable, but a deterministic function of the input. So whatever input data is coming in, based on that, whatever RDD is created, it can always be recreated. Fine. So quickly, important points about immutability: helps us in multithreading environment, helps us in fault tolerance, helps us in having efficient in-memory processing. Now let's see when to use RDDs. I mean, this question is relevant in current context, because now we already have Spark 2.0, 2.2 and 2.3 available, wherein we have newer data structures available on top of RDDs like data sets and data frames. So we are looking in this particular slide, what can be the use case in current context also, where you will prefer to use RDDs. Now the first scenario comes in where you want to apply the low level transformations and actions. And because you are working at the lowest level of data structure, it gives you a greater handle and greater control. So this is one scenario or consideration where you may prefer to use RDDs in the current context. Another very important factor, and I think this is the place where you will always prefer to use RDDs without having any wrappers on top of that, is where your data is highly unstructured, such as the live media byte, or you know, byte streams are coming, say, from some channels or from news feeds or some stream of text, etc. Because here you don't prefer to apply, say, schema on top of that binary data coming to your system. You may be porting that binary data coming to your system and feeding it to another system at their as a binary on their some machine ports. So in that case, you will prefer to use RDDs. There's no point using data frames and data sets, applying additional wrappers on top of RDDs. Another use case could be primarily on the similar lines, where you may prefer to forego the optimizations and maybe some performance benefits provided by data frames and data sets, but you are working at much lower level directly with binary streams and binary text formats. So these are some of the use cases where you will prefer to use RDDs in current context as well. So guys, that's it from my current video. Keep watching next videos for Spark internals, architectures and other details. Thanks for watching. Have a good day. Bye-bye.